Welcome to Authenticity, Belonging, Community, where I explore the ABCs of inclusivity by conversing with interesting guests from a variety of fields and disciplines about how they foster inclusive workplaces and communities. Today's guest wears what he would refer to as multiple hats in the art world. Yet it's not the hat metaphor and the actual one he was wearing that caught my attention. It was his energy and commitment to what he describes as radical joy. He embodies the title of this podcast in that he describes his work as centered in community, and he considers himself to be a space maker, space for reflection and for people to be their full selves. Welcome to Authenticity, Belonging, Community, the podcast that explores the ABCs of inclusivity. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and with me today is Joe Davis, and he is an award-winning spoken word artist and best-selling author who uses poetry to power possibility. Joe is a student and practitioner of radical joy, a deep-rooted wellspring of well-being that he cultivates in community through writing, music, theater, and dance. Based in Minneapolis, he tours internationally to join schools, faith spaces, and nonprofits to practice envisioning and embodying a world of collective liberation and human flourishing. Joe holds a Master of Arts degree in Theology of the Arts and also heads a multimedia production company, a soul funk band, and a racial justice education program. Joe Davis, welcome to the podcast.
Hey, thanks so much. Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yes, so good to have you. I'm so interested in your work. And I guess I'm just drop this here. John Noltner, a former guest on the podcast, recommended we connect, and I'm so glad he did so. That's a pretty impressive list of things you've got on there on that bio. But as I ask all guests, I'm really fascinated with the idea of identity and how we go about in this world, how we identify. And I want to ask you, how do you see yourself? What are the identities that are core to how you see yourself in the world?
That's a beautiful question. Yeah. I mean, I'm definitely an artist, a creator.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, I say I'm a man of many hats, you know, but the hats that I love to wear the most aren't the literal ones, but the metaphorical ones. As someone in the world who uses creativity and art as a catalyst for joy and healing and transformation. So that's something that I hold close to my heart that has a deep-rooted sense of purpose for me. I'm also a community member, a lover of community, a lover of people. A lot of the work that I do is centered in community. Like, I wouldn't be who I am today if it wasn't for those who poured into me and shaped me and mentored me and befriended me. I say I am who I am because someone loved me. And so I think those parts of my identity are really significant and really central in who I am. So community, artistry, creativity, that's how I would identify who I am.
That's how you move through the world.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I'm interested, it's in your bio and you mentioned it a little bit, just the word joy, using the word joy. Can you talk to listeners and tell us a little bit about, unpack that radical joy? What does that mean to you, and how do we see it in the world?
Yeah. I love to talk about that. So radical, shout out to Angela Davis, who talks about radical being, the definition being grasping at the root. Like if we look at the etymology of it, a radis, like a radish, right? Mm-hmm. And so getting to the heart of things, the center, the essence, the core. And so when I talk about radical joy, what I'm referring to is like a fullness of joy, a depth of joy. And I think then along the way to that joy, we will also experience sorrow and grief and heartbreak and anger and the full spectrum of human emotions. But in order to feel like an authentic, holistic fullness of joy, we have to experience all those things too. So that's why I'm really intentional about using that language. I long most to be in those places where I'm feeling whole and I'm able to access joy. But I know the only way to do that is to also create space to be in touch with those other emotions as well. And so a lot of the work I do is really as a space maker, using art to create space for people to unearth the deepest parts of themselves. Because I think a lot of times through life, we're pulled in so many different directions and we move at such a rapid pace. We move at like this pace of trauma. We move at this pace of productivity. We're only valued by what we can produce. But with art, I say, let's slow down. Let's breathe a little bit more slowly, a little bit more deeply. Let's move at the pace of relationship. And that's when we can create the space to experience things we've been running from, things we may not even know that were inside of us. And once we feel those things, then we can actually feel joy, a type of joy that's deep rooted, a type of joy that has sustenance to it, right? That's what I mean when I say radical joy. And that's what I try to create through my art.
Great. That's an awesome definition. I want to dig into that a little bit deeper. But before we go there, I want to ask you, I want to go back to the identity idea for a moment. And I want to ask you, have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity was or might be an obstacle?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, I mean, I think as a Black man growing up in the United States of America and the body and the skin that I'm in, yes. I could give you lots of stories about spaces I've walked into where, you know, who I am and how I look wasn't honored or respected or seen as valuable or worthy. And I think, you know, as a kid, when I was younger, that definitely impacted me. I mean, still does to this day, but I think I have a different posture than I did when I was younger. Because, you know, sometimes when you're young, you're just trying to find your way through the world and you're responding to your environment in ways that protect you or keep you safe. And so maybe there were times where I would shrink or hide or play small or just go along to get along. And now I've learned that that's not who I feel I'm called and created to be. Like, I want to take up space. I want to be unapologetic. I want to be authentic and practice vulnerability and courage, whatever space I'm in. So yes, there's definitely places where I know the fullness of my identity isn't accepted or appreciated. So for one, I try not to frequent those places. If I know, right? I don't want to go where I'm only tolerated. I want to go where I'm celebrated. Yeah. But if I do find myself in any of those spaces, I'm always reminding myself that I can show up fully and I don't have to truncate or cut off parts of who I am. And I do that because I want to be a possibility model for other people too, to say, hey, like, I want to show up as my full self. I also want you to show up as your full self, because I think that the world is better when we all are our full selves. One of my favorite quotes is by Howard Thurman. And Howard Thurman was a mentor and teacher to Dr. King. A lot of people are more familiar with Dr. King than they are with Howard Thurman, but I hope more people start to learn about him and his teachings. But one of his famous quotes, he says, "Don't ask what the world needs, but ask what makes you come fully alive, because what the world needs are more people who are fully alive." So when I say show up, right, I want people to show up fully alive, fully themselves, authentic, unapologetic. And so regardless of how people treat you in response to that, that's on them. But on me, as far as me and how I show up and how I invite other people to show up, it's all of us. It's the whole thing.
Yeah, that's a beautiful quote. Absolutely. Very powerful. I'm wondering if you can talk specifically about a specific incident or situation that you found yourself in which you noticed that the room was sort of going off the way you didn't want it to go, and how you created a space, as you've talked about, creating this space for people to be themselves, how you then were able to turn it around.
Yeah. No, that's a great question. So a lot of the work I do is around bridge building and connecting people across differences. And so I'm trying to think of a particular instant where, you know, I didn't have the respect or you know, the dignity of the people in the room. In a lot of spaces I go to, I'm maybe the only Black person or one of the few people of color. Yeah. And I'm invited to maybe to teach or to speak. And so a lot of times in those instances, I'm leading with questions and with invitations and with vulnerability, I think those have been helpful tools in my toolkit. And one of the reasons why I really love questions is because I learned long ago that if art proposes to have all the answers, it's not art, it's propaganda. Right? I'm not trying to, you know, police people and force any type of dogma or doctrine. I'm trying to figure it out just as much as anybody else. So I like to ask questions as I'm thinking of those experiences where I'm still trying to locate like a precise experience, but I can think of different times where, you know, I just ask people questions like, why did you say that? Why did you do that? And really my intention behind that is to not only call people out of whatever they're saying or doing, but to also call them in, to call them out of whatever behavioral pattern is like offensive or harmful, but to call them into deeper community, call them into deeper authenticity, call them into their humanity, right? Because a lot of times, I think the majority of the people I meet, if they're like acting funky around like my race or my culture or any other diverse part of my identity, a lot of times it's based on something they might not even be fully aware of, or they might not even fully understand. So how can I invite them to interrogate that for themselves? Because I think majority of the people want to be good people, right? Like, I haven't met a lot of people in my life, but sure, there's people out there who just want to cause harm intentionally. Yes, those people exist. But a lot of people in my community, thankfully, we're showing up for each other and we're trying to do the best that we can to not cause harm and to create the world we long to live in together. And so with that in mind, with that in heart, I'm always inviting people to step more fully into that and say, hey, like what you said, that was hurtful and this is the reason why. Or I wonder, did you hear what you just said? Like, let's like think about this together. And I might even lead with vulnerability and say, you know, there's times where I've said and done things that have like harmed others or been a mistake. I think we all have to come to terms with the reality that we're gonna mess up, right? Like this work is messy and awkward and uncomfortable. Yes. And sooner we can just like make peace with that and accept that, the sooner we can get to our commitment to repair. Right. So that's why I say whenever those things do happen, I lead with questions and vulnerability and humility in hopes of creating that space where we can actually get somewhere together.
Yes. Yes. I love all of that. That is very along the parallel with the work that I do as well. I really feel it's important for us to recognize in the room and be honest about the fact that this can be really, really messy. And that's okay. It's okay. I use the term, let's get comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yes. Yes, so, please.
Yeah, absolutely. And I love this idea of invitation, of inviting people in, no matter what, whether you feel hesitancy or what, just invite them in. And as you so well put, inviting them in, leading them in with questions. Mm-hmm. So talk to us a little bit about how do you use radical joy to transform the room?
Yes, yes, yes. No, I love that. That's one of my favorite things to do. I say I'm an activator of joy.
Yes.
So it's my belief that if we want to live in a world of more beauty and more joy, then every step along the way has to include that as well. Mm-hmm. And so when I'm creating this space, you know, I say, how do we move from like this whole cycle of guilt, blame, and shame, and then move more into saying, you know what, like those feelings may come up, yes. But if they do, how do we sit with them and say, you know what, I really want to live in a world of more beauty and joy. So how do we get there? And so that's what I love to do. And you know, telling stories and using poetry and music and dance and theater. Those are my tools in my toolkit. I think art is our most powerful tool that we have in our toolkit to create the world that we long to live in. And the reason being is that, you know, it just kind of hits us in the heart. Right. Sometimes we get stuck in our heads and we over intellectualize things. We've read all the right books. We've watched all the right films, listened to all the right podcasts, and we can say the right things. But then how do we get into the wisdom of our bodies? Right. How do we move our bodies and move together in community? And that's what I think art helps us do. We don't just sit and think and over intellectualize art, but we also dance. And we laugh and we move and we groove together. And so I really care a lot about, one of my mentors, Resma Minicum, he wrote a book called My Grandmother's Hands, and more recently, The Quaking of America. Mm. But he would call it somatic skill building. Mm. And so, somatic or soma, meaning the body, like body-centered work. Centering this work, when we talk about healing, when we talk about justice, when we talk about creating the world our hearts long to live in together, how do we get it into our bodies, right? How do we have more body practices? One of the metaphors I think about is if I want to learn a new instrument, playing a new instrument, I'm not just going to watch videos on YouTube or go to all the concerts and say, hey, I know how to play the saxophone now. And I never even picked up a saxophone. Yeah. Right? Or I read a book about playing the saxophone. You got to actually go and practice playing or practice playing the keys or the violin. Yeah, you have to actually get our practice. And the same thing with exercising. If I want to change my body and be healthier, I'm not just going to watch some DVDs or some YouTube videos about working out. I got to actually get it in my body. So that's the same thing with being in community. Right. Yeah. And working towards healing and working towards justice is we got to get practice. I think we're not well practiced. We got to get in our bodies and we do best what we do most. Right. And so the more we get our reps in, the more we practice showing up and loving each other, taking care of each other, being in community, being in conversation. That's how we get closer to that joy. That's how we get closer to that beauty and the world we want to live.
I love that metaphor of I guess it's a metaphor of practice. I mean, yeah. It's so true. I mean, you can't read a book and just figure out like, oh, I know everything about this, whether it's a sporting thing, you know, golf or football or basketball or instrument music or whatever. You actually have to do it. You have to practice. And it takes repeated practice in order for you to get to achieve more skill. And I think what you're talking about, like in terms of whether it's radical joy or storytelling or talking with one another, if we don't practice that, we're not going to develop better skills at doing that. I think that's a great thing that you pointed out. Now this, you may have already answered this question, but I want to throw it out there. So what one thing could you recommend to listeners that could act as a catalyst for a more inclusive society or workplace? It could be a lesson, a tool, a step, a rule, a story, whatever. And again, like I said, you may have already answered this with your radical joy, but is there one thing that you could recommend to listeners that would create a more inclusive society?
Yeah. I mean, I did say a lot about like, you know, centering this work in joy. I mm-hmm. shouted out a Resma Minicum. I would recommend like tapping into his work, some of his books and his podcast. Mm-hmm. But the main thing that I would really want to say is to find your freedom practice.
Find your freedom practice. Explain. Find your freedom practice. What is that?
Yeah. And so by that I mean is find a daily practice or ritual that allows you to feel more healed, whole, and alive. Mm. And come back to that practice again and again and again. Because it's of my belief that when we show up more healed, whole, and alive, that we help create a world that's more healed, whole, and alive. And that's contagious and inspiring and influences others around us. And so an example of a freedom practice. So for me, when I first found my freedom practice, it was at the height of the pandemic when I was cooped up in my apartment.
Yeah.
And I was like, I was freaking out. I'm a full-time artist. I wasn't getting any gigs. I didn't know what to do. I'm on my phone doom scrolling or I you know, looking at the news. And I jokingly say like, we shouldn't even call it the news. We should just call it the worst things that are happening near you.
That's what total agreement. Like. Total agreement.
Yeah. Just inundated with so much negativity. And it was really weighing on my body. And I was like, oh man, what am I going to do? Like with myself, with my life. But I just kind of felt this tug to like, turn off the technology, to turn off my phone, turn off my computer. I'm gonna stop binge watching Netflix. And I actually just sat on the edge of my bed and I began to like listen to my body. And I started to like, I put my hand over my heart and I felt like all this movement and this shaking. I was like, oh my goodness, what's going on inside of me? And the more I listened to my own body, I realized I was like, wow, there's anxiety there. Mm. And I listened, and even beneath that anxiety, there was like some grief. And I realized that what I was holding wasn't just my own. It was kind of a collective grief and a collective anxiety. And that's when I started developing a practice of listening to my body and of meditation and breathing. And I even started going to therapy for the first time. And I started going deeper into this inner world and this inner work of tending to like a deep sense of self and well-being. And that for me is my freedom practice.
Yeah.
Right. And I also, you know, I journal a lot. Every poem and song I write is like an expression of that healing journey that I've taken myself. And yeah. So I want people to find that for themselves, though, because what my freedom practice, what works for me may or may not work for you. Right. And so I know for different people that like to do different things. I have friends who are nature lovers, and they have to get outside. They have to go camping and fishing, and they have to be by the trees and get the sunlight and the fresh air. And that's what allows them to feel more healed, whole, and alive. And some people are dancers or yogis. They're in the yoga, Pilates, or martial arts. They got to move their bodies, whatever the case may be. But I encourage you to find your freedom practice, whatever that is for you. And it may change from season to season, from different times in your life, but find something you can come back to again and again and have a commitment to do it every day or as often as possible. Put it on your calendar, because what I realize is that we have to actively, intentionally create space for these things, because no one else is going to do it for us.
Yes.
Right? Like we live in a world that just is going to just push us forward, business as usual. And if we don't make time for our wellness, we'll be forced to make time for our illness.
Yes. Right?
How do you say yes to yourself first? Right? One of my mentors. Said, yep. One of my mentors said, you have to have your no make room for your yes. So when are you going to say no to anything? I'm making this meeting for myself on my calendar at, 7 a.m. in the morning. This is my meeting for myself, for my freedom practice. I'm going to do it. I'm going to stay committed to it, because I know this is going to allow me to show up better, not only for myself, but also for others and everyone around me. Yeah, I really hope that everyone can find their freedom practice.
That is beautiful. That's really great. Yes, I would completely agree with that. And it's different for everyone. I personally am a meditator. I meditate twice a day for 20 minutes, once in the morning, once in the afternoons. And I've been doing that for 15 years or so. And it just really centers me. And as you said, you're just really listening to your body and what's going on. So I can't more wholeheartedly endorse that. That is a beautiful, beautiful thing. All right, we're going to shift gears just a little bit. So we all perceive definitions to particular words slightly differently. And of course, we come to the table with our own set of biases. But if I were to ask you what it means to be authentic, how would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
I love that. I love that. I talk a lot about authenticity.
Mm-hmm.
So authenticity, I think, to me, is about being honest with yourself and with others. It's about, doing some real deep work to learn, like, who you are, what makes you tick, what your fears are and your hopes are, your dreams, and having a clear understanding of that. And then being able to live into that, to lean into that and say, oh yeah, this is truly who I am. This is truly what I want. This is truly what I need. And sometimes it takes work to even identify what that is. And I can just be really personal and vulnerable with you and talk about my own journey. Like growing up as a kid, I was really sick. My childhood was plagued with illness. So I had some pretty traumatic experiences around sickness, and thankfully, my family was there to care for me. But I think during my childhood, some of my trauma became, some of the ways I responded to that trauma was becoming a people pleaser and, trying to help others at the expense of myself, and not even being able to identify and communicate my own needs became a pattern. And so through my freedom practice, right, through meditation, through therapy, through multiple ways of processing, I've been able to learn how to counter that and how to have healthier patterns. I mean, it's a lifelong journey too, right? I don't want to paint this picture as if like I've arrived and I figured it all out. But for me, that journey has allowed me to tap more into my own authenticity and to say, okay, I can better differentiate between what someone else is feeling and wanting, and what I'm feeling and wanting. Because as a people pleaser, as a highly compassionate and empathetic person, I would take on other people's feelings as my own. And then I would have this sense of responsibility for everyone and everything when I'm like, actually, everyone and everything isn't my responsibility. Yes, I do have a sense of responsibility and accountability, but for what's mine, right?
Yes.
And how I show up for you and how I'm treating you, how I'm treating myself.
Yeah.
Right. And so that to me is a journey of authenticity, like understanding like who I am, what I want, what I need, and how it differentiates from others as well, how it's in relationship with others.
Yeah. That is beautiful. That's really great. And I love, you know, you've mentioned this a few times about being intentional, and about having a clear understanding and really going deep inside. I think that speaks a lot to this idea of authenticity. Joe, thank you so much for this conversation. This has just been really terrific. We have a lot of, I say this all the time, but we have a lot of commonalities. We have more in common than we have different, which is, you know, one of my big things, my big focus on the work. But before we end this, I want to ask you one last question that you could share something with listeners. And could you recommend a book, some music, a movie, a play, something that has inspired you recently and tell us why?
Ooh, that's good. I'm such a lover of art. Like I love music. I love theater. I love film. So it's hard to narrow it down to just.
If you got a couple, we'll take a couple. That's all right.
Yeah, I want to give a really good one. What have I really been? One of my new favorite films is this film called Everything, Everywhere, All at Once. I don't know if you've seen or heard of it.
Yeah, I loved it. Loved it.
And the reason why, though, because I'm such a philosopher. I'm such a geek. Like, yes, there was a sci-fi, you know, it was a lot going on, a lot of layers there. And you could probably narrow that whole story down to like it's about this woman who's doing her taxes and she's, you know, going through struggles with her husband and with her daughter. But as she's traveling through time and space if you've seen it, she's also confronting like her inner self and like her own anxiety and depression and she's tapping into her authenticity. She's how to mend her relationships to herself and to her husband and to her daughter. And she just goes on this brilliantly crafted journey. And I think that's just a profound film. Like just when you're really able to sit with it and see some of the deeper meaning. So I would definitely recommend that. For anyone and everyone. Yeah,
absolutely. Actually, someone asked us, my wife and I, the other day to explain the movie, and I was like, I don't think I can.
You can.
You just did, and I thought it was really great. The explanation was really right on. It was right on. Bravo.
I've seen it multiple times, and like just watch. Like I saw myself and fell in love with it, and then I invited other people and went to go see it with other people, and I think. That's the type of art that I want to see more of in the world. Cause I mean, I'm already just a big science fiction geek. Like I grew up on like Star Wars and comic books. And so I love that element of it too was really well done. But I also appreciate when arts, you know, earlier when we were talking, I said, I'm an edutainer, right? Using
education
and entertainment. And so like it's fun and playful and exploratory in the scientific realm, but then there's also that part that gets to your heart, that part that's like that it speaks to like the human condition and how do we heal, how do we connect with each other. And I think that's what that type of film does. And that's the type of art I want to see more of in the world, the type of art that I hope I can create and offer others. So
right on. I totally agree. Thank you so much, Joe. Really appreciate this conversation.
Absolutely. Yeah, it was a pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks again for listening to Authenticity, Belonging, Community, the podcast that explores the ABCs of inclusivity. For those who are new to the podcast, welcome. We appreciate you listening and hope you discovered something here that will make you want to revisit as well as share with others. And if you're a returning listener to the podcast, formerly known as Incognito the Podcast, We hope the new brand aligns with what you've come to expect from the show. In our continuing journey to expand our listenership, I'm making the big ask of you to help share and spread the word. I've raved many a time on this podcast about what a delight it is to speak with the wide variety of guests we've had and how each episode offers so much to take away and learn from. I hope you will rave as well. I welcome your comments, suggestions, and reviews. Until next week, keep asking questions.